Mumia Abu-Jamal. I've been on death row since July of 1982. In fact, I've been on several death rows in Pennsylvania. I'm a writer, a journalist, a columnist, and a professional revolutionary. First name is Swahili or African, and my middle and last name are Arabic, so it means Father Jamal. So, you know, I grew up in a poor neighborhood in what's commonly called the PJs, the projects. My most formative years were spent in North Philly, in the heart of North Philadelphia. Except one would have to admit, for my exposure to the Black Panther Party, there's nothing remarkable about my childhood that distinguishes me from millions of other young kids of my generation. What makes it really unremarkable is the context, the times. We're talking about the late 60s and the early 70s, which was the explosion era of the Black Liberation Movement. So there were many people of my generation who were active in the Black Panther Party, the Republic of New Africa, what's called SNCC, the Southern Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, the Nation of Islam, and other organizations that were active and overtly active at that time. But I remember it as probably one of the most exciting and liberational times of my life. Of course, for most people, their teen years are times of freedom. You know? Mine was a time of ultra freedom, or super freedom, in that it was a tremendous learning experience. You know, the very fact that I, even from this place, am a journalist who writes and communicates to thousands and thousands of people every week. Its embryo can be found in the fact that I worked as a Panther in what's called the Ministry of Information. And that means that I worked by filing reports to the National Black Panther Party Journal called the Black Panther Black Community News Service. So I was trained as a revolutionary journalist, trained to present the positions of the Black Panther Party from that revolutionary Black revolutionary perspective.
Serving as Minister of Information for the Philadelphia branch of the Black Panther Party for most of his teen years, Jamal got serious journalistic training. In his later days as a journalist, he became known as the voice of the voiceless on account of his willingness to publicize the views and actions of minorities and the poor. His commentaries, highly critical of the American government and police, have been published in over 40 newspapers in the United States and abroad, in addition to American periodicals such as The Nation. Shortly before 4 o'clock on the cold, windswept morning of December 9, 1981, African-American sidewalk jewelry vendor William Cook, 25, drove his Volkswagen Beetle the wrong way down 13th Street in Philadelphia, a one-way strip lined with sex shops and streetwalkers. White police officer Daniel Faulkner, a newlywed and also 25, spotted Cook's car and stopped him after the Beetle made a left onto Locust Street. A quarrel ensued. Faulkner attempted to spread eagle and search Cook. Punches flew. Faulkner managed to subdue William Cook by holding him down on the hood of the patrol car and hitting him across the head with a flashlight. Enter Cook's brother, Wesley, better known as Mumia Abu-Jamal. For reasons no one except Jamal knows, the 27-year-old award-winning journalist and activist, moonlighting as an all-night cab driver, happened to be in a parking lot across the street after getting a flat tire and saw Faulkner striking his brother. Jamal ran toward the two men and tried to stop the officer. Minutes later, Daniel Faulkner's reinforcements arrived too late. By then, William Cook shuddered on the sidewalk. The officer, fatally shot in the face and back, lay on the pavement. And Mumia Abu-Jamal, also critically wounded by a gunshot to his chest, sat slumped on the curb in a pool of blood. Nearby lay his licensed pistol, which he carried for protection after being robbed in his taxi 3 times. Police took their fallen colleague to nearby Thomas Jefferson University Hospital, where he was pronounced dead shortly after arrival. They arrested William Cook on assault charges. Recovering on a hospital bed and protesting his innocence, Jamal was charged with Faulkner's murder and ordered held without bail.
I approached Mumia very gently because he looked dead. And I kept shaking him and shaking him, trying to get him awake. He was in some kind of unconscious state at that time. And when I finally aroused him, his eyes didn't focus and he kept saying, "They're trying to kill me, they're trying to kill me. I'm innocent, they're trying to kill me." And I kept shaking him and he finally aroused to who was there, who was talking to him. And I told him his condition. I told him he had a bullet in him and it had to be removed. And after I kept talking to him and trying to convince him, he agreed to have the bullet removed. It was a horrible experience. It was horrible. It was horrible to see how they beat my baby brother up. We know that, you know, he's been under FBI surveillance since he was 15 years old. What was the purpose of that? You know, it's a political thing because maybe perhaps he was one of the Black Panthers early on in his life when he was only 15 years old. And we all know what the history has been, the government behavior towards Black Panthers or any resistance group. I believe that's the beginning of that. They didn't fear a child, a 15-year-old child that had a weapon or anything like that. They feared a 15-year-old child that could write, and educate people about the world around them. That's what they feared, because that's all Mumia did in the Black Panther Party. He wrote for them. So obviously they feared a child with a pen. I mean, that's unbelievable. And over the years, as he began to write as a journalist, obviously they feared him more. If during that trial, and I sat through that trial, Joseph McGill alluded to his participation in the Black Panther Party, then obviously it all ties together. It's a political thing. And they want to execute all of these people.